All right, we are back again here with AWS What's Next, the show where we cover the latest launches from Amazon Web Services. We just had a very exciting session on Amazon Interactive Video Service, but switching gears a little bit, no pun intended, we're talking a little bit about AWS DeepRacer, which we will cover in just a moment. But before we get into that, joining us here, fresh faced on the show, Eddie Kaleha, if I'm pronouncing that correctly. Eddie, thank you for joining us. And as a senior software engineer here at Amazon, I know you are closely familiar with the DeepRacer itself. But why don't you tell folks sort of your relation to this service? That's very exciting.
Yep. So I've been on DeepRacer pretty much since its inception. And today I oversee the software stacks for the virtual environment, the reinforcement learning algorithms, and the device software, which is what we're going to be talking about here today.
That's awesome. Welcome to the show, Eddie.
Well, thank you, Robert.
Yeah, I'm chock full of puns today. So switching gears and now driving right along, we're here to talk about DeepRacer Evo, which is an exciting new change or improvement, a new set of features. We'll talk specifics, but my point being here, let's talk a little bit broadly about what DeepRacer is, because I know that there are many enthusiasts who are very aware of what it is. But for folks who have not seen it at all, Eddie, can you give us a brief rundown on DeepRacer?
Yeah, absolutely. DeepRacer is a 1/18 scale autonomous driving RC vehicle, which launched at reInvent 2018. And we really built it because we wanted to sort of onboard people with reinforcement learning and make it the fastest way to teach folks about reinforcement learning. And so we built out the platform in two parts. We have a virtual environment where you can go train your models virtually. And then we have a physical device where you take those models that you trained in the virtual environment and you deploy them down onto the physical device. And sort of while we were developing DeepRacer back in 2018, we were kind of having challenges between the groups. So, you know, it was like the engineering group would challenge the science team. And out of that kind of was born the idea of having the DeepRacer League, which I know we'll talk about in a little bit. But this was sort of a way to see who had the best model, so to speak, and sort of compete. And so we brought that to customers as well back in the initial launch of DeepRacer.
Now, Eddie, you mentioned that this is meant as an introductory experience for reinforcement learning. Can you talk a little bit more about that? Let's say, you know, we have somebody who gets started with DeepRacer and gets really hooked on reinforcement learning. How can they expand upon that within AWS?
Well, we have lots of great learning resources if they want to learn more about reinforcement learning, and I'm sure some of the moderators will put that in the chat. But if they want to go further than DeepRacer, you know, it works actually on two other AWS platforms, AWS RoboMaker and AWS SageMaker. So once you start getting comfortable with reinforcement learning, you can go over to AWS SageMaker RL and start building out more reinforcement learning models there and continue to grow your knowledge and actually leverage reinforcement learning for whatever your production use may be.
Yeah, I was gonna say, you know, when folks think reinforcement learning, for anyone who's had a cursory introduction to machine learning and AI, reinforcement learning can be this thing that's very scary at first glance. But there's just something about being able to test your model. Oh, Rob's video dropped, he's back. Eddie, when you get the chance, just disable and re-enable your video and everything will be back again. But I was just gonna say, you know, reinforcement learning can be scary, but DeepRacer makes it easy to sort of understand the behavior of your model because you're quite literally having your car drive as a result of the model that you've loaded onto it, right? So you get this very tangible experience of like tying real world phenomena to this model that you've trained, and there's just something very real about that interaction that I think helps a lot of people really start to understand the concepts at play here.
Yeah, absolutely. And if I may just add to that, I mean, one of the things that differentiates reinforcement learning from like traditional machine learning techniques is this sort of idea of thinking about incentivizing behavior. Whereas, you know, in regular machine learning, it's sort of like, hey, you just want to train this thing to, for example, and this is a joke I'm sure I'll use over and over again throughout the broadcast, but like a cat dog detector, which is something that, you know, when we all learn about machine learning, this is like one of the first things we do. And then all it can do is really, hey, tell you if something's a cat or a dog. But in reinforcement learning, it's really learn the behavior. And one of the cool things that you can do is, hey, I train this car to drive a particular track, and then I can go, so say, for example, the Barcelona track. and then I can go and see how it performs on like the reInvent track. So that is super cool. It really learned the behavior of how to drive and what to do and what sort of actions to take. And thinking about that is really an exciting part of reinforcement learning.
So, yeah, definitely. But on the topic of what other problems it can solve, you mentioned the cat dog detector as an academic example. Can you just give us some other real world examples that reinforcement learning is best situated to solve?
Yep, and just a quick correction, Robert. So reinforcement learning won't really do very well with the cat, more like supervised learning. But reinforcement learning is used, like, for example, to manage like the temperature at data centers where temperature is really critical. And you know, normally this is managed by something called the PID, but a reinforcement learning algorithm can basically, you can incentivize it to make it warmer or colder depending on what target temperature you want. And it's also used sort of in the financial sector. It turns out that whenever you have something that requires a strategy, reinforcement learning is a very good tool. And you know, if you just go and Google on the internet, you'll see reinforcement learning, people usually benchmark it against video games. Because again, there's this sort of like strategy concept in video games of like, hey, which sort of way do I want to solve the maze, or how do I get the most points, that sort of stuff. Reinforcement learning is really good at solving those type of problems, as it does with AWS DeepRacer, where the strategy is, hey, how do I get around the track the fastest?
Yeah, chat is astutely paying attention here. Rob falls off the video call every once in a while and comes in, but you know, the names and titles will be slightly off, but everyone who's been here since the start of the session will know who's who, so we'll leave it as is.
Sorry, folks. I think this just kind of is a testament to how difficult live video is, as you saw from the previous segment. We're experiencing some technical difficulties. Please bear with us.
Yeah, Eddie, while I ask the next question, if you get the chance to disable and re-enable video, that it'll fix it again. Hopefully this doesn't keep hounding us. lots of moving parts in live video. Go ahead, Rob.
So, Eddie, let me just play that back to you very quickly and make sure I got it all. So DeepRacer here, basically giving newcomers and veterans alike a way to kind of get their hands on a solution or a scenario where the concepts of reinforcement learning are made very fun, very visceral. You know, you get immediate feedback about, you know, and a goal to drive your incentive to learn these things. And then once you have those foundations, then you can broaden out to using the underlying foundational AWS services, RoboMaker and SageMaker. You use those tools to solve lots of different kinds of real world problems, including, you know, controlling temperature for various industrial HVAC systems, financial models, et cetera. Is that right?
Yeah, you can definitely go and expand and build on those services. I would say, you know, you probably use RoboMaker more for like your robotics needs and, you know, sort of like for a virtual environment, which is what we use it for. We run Gazebo, and that's the virtual simulator that we use to simulate racing around a track. And SageMaker, you know, it's just a fantastic platform. It's Amazon's all-stop, all-shop machine learning platform, and you can build pretty much any machine learning algorithm on SageMaker. So it's absolutely fantastic. Like I said, DeepRacer runs on both of these wonderful platforms, and it's how we bring it to you.
Awesome. I wanted to touch on Gazebo there really quickly, so we won't go too deep onto the fundamentals of machine learning 101. That could take us so much time. But using the simulator to train your model, but also to be able to do that racing and competing. You mentioned before the ability to race around these different named tracks, Barcelona, New York, Las Vegas, for example. The virtual side of this is the DeepRacer League, where when folks want to compete, they can actually compete digitally against one another. And this is something that we've had for at least the past year from my familiarity with it. And, you know, to tie this all into where the goals are and what the competition is really about, it was this old goal of being able to make it around the track as quickly as possible. This is racing 101, right? But we're here to talk about DeepRacer Evo, and I know there are some new changes that make this entire competition a little bit more exciting. I figured I'd let you sort of share what's new here as the person who was on the team that built it.
Well, so with DeepRacer Evo, we wanted to sort of let the DeepRacer solve more complicated problems, and that means more complex environments. And in order to do that, you know, if you think about it, when we launched the initial DeepRacer, all it could do was kind of see. You know, you think of yourself, you can see, and that's one sense. But if we want to solve more complicated problems, we kind of give it some other senses. And you know, the technical term for this is increasing the state. But really, it's just we added the ability for it to learn how far away things are and to learn how far away things are sort of around it. And this helps us support more complex environments. So how did we do that? Well, the first thing we did is we added an extra camera module, and this created essentially a stereo camera. And this works just the same way that your eyes work, right? We have two eyes. This is how we do depth perception. You know, your brain does it a little different than the Deep Racer would, as you can imagine. And so that allows us to know how far away something is, and that information can get encoded into the machine learning model. And then we added a LiDAR, which LiDAR, what it does is it uses lasers to determine how far away things are around it. And you'll see it, you'll see later in the demo that it's always spinning. That's because it's taking data all around its surroundings. And then it kind of tells you whether, hey, there's an object here on my right and how far away it is, or there's nothing there. And so adding these two components and having these two sensors really allow us to expand the AWS Deep Racer. And it allows us to do fun events like the F1 event. And if folks don't know what that is, they can go check it out at aws.amazon.com/DeepRacerF1. And I'm sure there'll be a link provided to that in the chat as well. Where, you know, we, at the end of the day, we sort of took racing strategies from professional racers and then raced them against our top developers up on the leaderboards and then raced them all against each other. And having, you know, sort of these extra sensors and the ability to train in these extra formats, which we're gonna get into here in a second, is really what the Deep Racer Evo is about. And so we actually enabled that on the virtual environment at reInvent 2019, and people could get started working on those models right away. And they did. We have such competitive people up on our leaderboards. It's crazy what our customers are doing and how engaged they are and how vibrant the community is. And then on July 13th, we launched the Deep Racer Evo Sensor Kit, which now allows you to take those models that you trained in the virtual environment and actually get to see them in the real car. And we previewed this at reInvent this past year in 2019, but now it's time for, you know, for the developers to go on and show us what they can do by training these models and deploying them down to the car.
So I am a, I live in New York, I've been a lifelong New Yorker, but when I lived in the Bay Area a little while ago, I saw a lot of these cars that would drive around on the streets. And when you mentioned these spinning LiDAR sensors, I feel like I saw a lot of those around. Are we talking the same type of technology here?
It's similar. Most self-automated driving cars actually are based on perception models, not reinforcement learning. But they do have a bunch of LiDAR sensors, depending on, you know, the company and how they've implemented the self-driving car. I think it'd be pretty hard to implement the self-driving car without LiDARs, but not my area of expertise. So.
Great. Well, one of the things, as someone who's followed along with the Deep Racer League over the past year, is the concept of AWS subject matter experts who help service at the events and work on some of these cars and help folks load their models on, much like in F1 or traditional racing, we call that the pit crew. And so part of being in the pit crew is the ability to work and manipulate this physical device, the Deep Racer, that has a lot of traditional parts to a regular traditional car, but with some extra bells and whistles to handle the machine learning model and performing that inference on the fly. I was wondering, is there any chance we would actually be able to get a look at some of this hardware for the Deep Racer Evo?
Yeah, I'd want to see it. I think that'd be cool.
But Chad, you want to see this real car?
Yeah.
Well, just happen to have one right here.
Oh, wonderful.
This is a Deep Racer Evo, and you can see the LiDAR spinning up here. Hopefully you guys can tell that spinning. And now the car really has two batteries. There's two parts to it. So right up here, maybe we start with regular Deep Racer, and you can kind of take a peek. This is sort of the brain of the device that's housed in this case. This is where we have an Intel Atom processor, which is what, you know, makes all the decisions. It's the CPU and GPU that manages everything that goes on, all the software systems on the device. And so that's powered by this fellow right here, which is the compute battery, which conveniently slides underneath the case over here. And then down here, and I don't know if you guys will be able to see it, but it's the servo. So these are sort of the Deep Racer's legs. And this is the little motor that makes this, well, essentially an RC car, and makes it go. So now let's talk about, and then there's one more feature, which is this back LED that we added for customization. So, you know, you can customize your Deep Racer whatever color you want. I think we offer about 8 colors. And so now with the Evo, so that's kind of Deep Racer V1. And then with the Evo, what we did is we added, you see now there's 2 cameras. So originally for the Deep Racer, there would just be 1. So these are sort of, they kind of look like eyes, and that's because they're doing depth sensing. So this is how we do it. And, you know, you could take these things off. Let me not try in the sense that I may actually put this whole thing down here since it's a demo. But you can take these off and go back to the regular Deep Racer, the non-Evo version. And likewise, you could take off the LiDAR. And so the LiDAR mounts up here. It has a nice mounting plate. And then that's pretty much the gist of it. So once you get this guy, and you know, you can just add in the 2 sensors and get our latest software, and you can convert your car into an Evo.
Eddie, where's the nitro booster?
Well, we're still working on that one.
Of course.
We'll take this back to the product team and see if they, how they feel about it.
I'm still waiting for us to have a you know, like an open circuit competition where people can mod their Deep Racers and just show up with any ridiculous sort of contraption that they've modified, like you know, supercharged batteries or supercharged processors, like almost the, you know, the crazy CPU benchmarks, but for your own Deep Racer.
And Nathan's comment about how when is it gonna fly hover Deep Racer, please. I feel like we're slowly gonna edge our way toward like an AWS BattleBots league instead of a Deep Racer league at some point.
Well, I don't know. I mean, you know, the future is definitely, you know, we're always looking for new and creative ways to teach people about great technology that is machine learning. But, you know, interestingly enough, at reInvent, if you made your way down to the pits in 2018, and I believe also in 2019, you could actually customize your Deep Racer shell. And people came up with all sorts of interesting customizations that made them look really, really, really cool. And we had a contest on that as well, as to who had the best customization putting stickers on it. So not quite as exciting yet as, you know, bringing your own CPU and doing all these interesting things to make the Deep Racer just zoom its way through. But we are, you know, we do allow some customization.
Well, Eddie, you know? Everyone knows that putting flame decals on the side of your Deep Racer shaves at least 3.5 seconds off your lap time. That's of course, what I did to my shell. But we actually had a question in chat around sort of the basics of how this works, because hey, we're AWS, we handle cloud computing. They're wondering, is the Deep Racer sending the real-time input up to the cloud to be processed to make decisions, or where is that actual decision making happening?
That's actually an excellent question. So remember from earlier in the talk, we have 2 things. We have the virtual environment, and we can talk a little bit about how that's architected, but as you guys have mentioned before, that runs on RoboMaker and SageMaker, and we have those 2. So we basically orchestrate a communication between those 2 services where we collect data on RoboMaker, and this is on the virtual environment, and then we send that data over to SageMaker. Now, once you've trained a model, and this is what's cool, the service will actually give you what's called a frozen model. And it doesn't mean we put it on ice or anything, but it basically means that it's ready to deploy onto the device. Now, once it goes onto the device, we run on the Deep Racer software stack on the device, uses an inference engine called Intel OpenVINO. And Intel OpenVINO optimizes the model so that it can run as fast as possible. And then it actually runs on the CPU on the device. And then what happens is like, you know, from the Evo, you get data from the 2 cameras and you get data from the LiDAR. That LiDAR goes to the model. And then the model, the machine learning model here, makes a decision as to what action you should take. So should you go left? Should you speed up? You know, how do we navigate this track? And that happens at around 15 FPS. So every 66 milliseconds, we're making a decision as to which way we can drive and how fast we should be going. And that's the behavior that you guys incentivized up on the cloud in the actual service.
Awesome. And that makes a lot of sense, right? You know, if you're accepting real-time inputs as you have a moving vehicle, you would want the time for the making those decisions to be as low as possible. So moving that model off of the cloud and onto the actual device while challenging from a compute and a powering perspective is really the only way to have something like this that's truly responsive in real time, right?
That's absolutely right, Nick. If we tried to hit the server, just the simple latency would just kill us. You know, if you think like good latency at like 100 milliseconds, for example, is too much. I mean, you're going too fast, your car is going to go off the track, and you're going to end up against the wall.
maybe someday we can deploy an outpost to run a local server and run a little compute on the outpost just 10 feet away.
You could do that. No, not impossible. You could totally do that, but you find you get a really good performance by running it on the edge, which is what it's doing. And it's probably a lot cheaper than running a local outpost and easier to set up.
Yeah, it might be a little bit cheaper. I think that's the understatement of the century there. Now, Eddie, one thing I feel like we need to remind the chat on a regular basis here is that what you've described there is the end-to-end flow of what it's like to actually take your model and run the car on the track. But in fact, to improve this iteratively, you don't need the physical vehicle, right? You can do this in a simulator. And that means that you don't need to buy one of these things in order to start, you know, refining your model, getting ready to compete in the league. And I want to just make sure that message gets out.
That's absolutely true, Robert. You don't need a AWS DeepRacer device to start to get your hands, you know, to basically start learning about reinforcement learning. You could go to the AWS DeepRacer console and you could get going right there. You can iterate there. And in fact, you're absolutely correct. You improve your models on the AWS DeepRacer console before you deploy them down to the device. You can race in our virtual league. And you could basically just get all those learnings on there. But there's something really cool about like seeing something in a simulated virtual environment and then taking that and deploying it down to the device and actually seeing it do it in real life. Because in a lot of machine learning applications, you don't really get that sense of gratification. Most of the time, as data scientists, you are looking at metrics to determine, and all that stuff's really important. But there's just something that makes me smile every time I go down to the pits and see people racing it and seeing it for the first time. That experience, I think, you can only really get with the device.
Yeah, the excitement is really palpable. If you're ever, there's lots of actually footage from Deep Racer League and as well as the events in person and the online variant as well. You can check that out on YouTube if you want to get a flavor for what that looks like. But I'm going to point us to the new challenges within Deep Racer Evo that it can help us, and new competitions that it spurs that I will say will make the excitement for these races even more exciting. So again, the previous goal was to make it around the track as quickly as possible, and this may still hold true. But with these new sensors, you mentioned we can detect some new parts of our environment. What are the new challenges that we enable in Deep Racer League or with Deep Racer Evo now?
Yeah, so we actually introduced two new racing formats. We have object avoidance, where we put some boxes down on the track, and your task is still going to be to get around as quickly as possible, but now you have to teach your model to dodge these boxes. Because if you crash into them, well, you get a penalty. It's not good. And then we also enabled head-to-head racing, and the way we train this into what we call bot cars, which are sort of cars that are on prescribed paths around the track. And then you have to be able to avoid those cars and deal with lane changing and things of that nature. Now here it's a little bit different. We run, we have a qualifier at the end of the month where we race the top 32 racers against each other in a tournament head to head. So in a way you still wanna go faster, but you wanna go faster, you wanna be able to beat your opponent and you wanna be able to not crash into him or her because otherwise, you get a penalty and you're not doing well. So this is really the new racing format that the Deep Racer Evo allows us to do. And so these have just been super cool. And we've seen a lot of just people enthusiastic going at it going at it on the leaderboard. And then, again, just to bring back the F1 event where we actually held a 12-car Grand Prix where you got to race against, you know, if you made it, if you qualified for the Grand Prix, you got to race against Daniel Ricciardo and Tatiana Calderon, which are both F1 drivers. So all this super cool stuff is really enabled by having those extra sensors on there.
Awesome. And you may have mentioned this before, given sort of the relationship between the sensors and the base Deep Racer vehicle. But just so that it's very clear, the release of Deep Racer Evo hardware, you can either buy both of them as a bundle, or you can buy the new sensor kit and apply that to your existing Deep Racer vehicle. So if you've already purchased one, you can simply apply the new kit to it, right?
That's absolutely correct. And in fact, if you got a Deep Racer as early as reInvent 2018, you can go on Amazon.com, purchase a Deep Racer Evo kit, which is available at a limited price, a limited offer of $149 today. And you can take your car and then turn it from a Deep Racer to a Deep Racer Evo. Or you can purchase the Deep Racer, a Deep Racer car with the Evo sensor kit together, have it shipped to your home, and get started with Deep Racer Evo right away.
Wonderful. We mentioned before the experience of, you know, you simulate in the console and you load that model onto the vehicle. You know, when I put on my engineering hat, I think like, oh, loading a model somewhere, you know, like maybe I'm not proficient in machine learning. That sounds like it could be daunting. Maybe you could walk us through just like the steps, either verbally in console, whatever you think would be easiest for basically just like loading a model onto the Deep Racer, because I think this distinction of like, you know, going from the cloud to this physical device, they're quite literally separated physically. How easy is that experience with Deep Racer?
It's extremely easy. All you have to do to load a model onto the device is you download a model from the AWS Deep Racer console. Once it's ready, there'll be a button that says download model for deploying it on the car. And that's going to download essentially a tarball. And then all you have to do is basically go to the AWS Deep Racer console, which you can access on your browser. And now I think one thing that to mention here is that the device console runs locally over your router. So, you know, you get the IP out and you do that when you provision the device. So you go, you hit the Deep Racer device console. And then there's literally a button that says load model, and then you just load the model, and that's it.
Awesome. Very exciting stuff.
Yeah. Sounds very intuitive. I wonder if we could see a demo of it.
We can, actually, if you guys want me to share my screen.
Yeah, go right ahead. I know the fans in chat are chomping at the bit to see it, so.
Cool. Give me just 1 second here to make sure that this is up, and then I will share my screen and show you guys basically what the Evo looks like and where you can just load a model.
Awesome.
And it'll be relatively straightforward, as you will see. And again, that's all you really have to do. And let's see if it'll come up here for me a second. This is live TV. I just had it up.
Yeah, while you're sharing that screen, I guess I'll give a recap for folks that may have just tuned in. This is the AWS What's Next show. Lots of recap, AWS being Amazon Web Services, the technology arm of Amazon, create lots of services for developers to power the technology, webs, apps, experiences you see on the internet today. We spoke a little bit earlier with IVS, the interactive video service, the tech that powers Twitch, recently released as a service from AWS, so very exciting there. And right now we're joined by Eddie Kaleha talking to us about the AWS Deep Racer, a fully autonomous vehicle, a miniature vehicle, that you can train your own models for using machine learning reinforcement learning, to be more specific, and then try see both, you know, in through the simulator or in person, how your vehicle will react and travel around a racetrack. Eddie showed us some of the bits and pieces and the new features with the Deep Racer Evo, the LiDAR sensor, the ability to do depth sensing, and we're just about to see a demo of actually using the console to be able to experience this.
Yep, so I'll go ahead and share my screen.
Yeah.
And and 1 second here, live TV Zoom is...
Yeah, no worries. If there's any errors, just let me know. It might be something on my end.
Okay, there we go. Okay, cool. All right, can you guys see that?
Yeah.
So this is the AWS DeepRacer device console. And I've actually put us where you would go to load a model. So you see the model, the selection here, what we have. And we'll go back to control vehicle in just a second. So I've already loaded a couple of models on here. And these are or sample models, which ship with the software. So these are models to sort of get you going. If you don't want to train a model and you just want to see the car do some avoidance or use some of the sensors, we provide these for you. They tell you what the sensor configuration is. So for example, this one is just stereo camera without the LiDAR, so it doesn't have the LiDAR signal. This was essentially an older DeepRacer model where it just has the one camera. And then this is one that leverages LiDAR and the sensor camera. So when you come from the AWS console and you download your model into your computer, you could just hit upload model. This is gonna pull up just as you would imagine a file selector. And then you just click on your model and it loads it here. And that's it. That's the whole model uploading procedure. Now, once you've uploaded your model, you guys are seeing sort of my living room here. This is actually the landing page for the AWS DeepRacer Eco. And we've added some new visualizations, such as LiDAR. And you can see the LiDAR right now is moving around. And the reason for that is because I'm putting my hand actually next to it. So you can see it actually physically detect things close to the device. And if we wanted to load a model, all we'd have to do is go here from our model selection list. And this is only going to allow you to load models that the model was trained with a particular sensor configuration. The model doesn't work if, let's say, I train something with stereo and LiDAR and I don't have LiDAR plugged in, then it's not going to work, which is why we have here a display showing you what sensors you currently have connected. And so, if we just click on this, it'll ask you, hey, do you want to load this model? And you say yes. And it takes about 10 or 12 seconds. And this is because just sort of like loading a model requires to load all the weights and all the math sort of speed into the GPU. And this takes a little bit of time. But once it's all set and ready to go, this will turn green. And then that's it. Then we would hit start. Which I'm not going to do because the DeepRacer is going to fly off my
it's going to avoid the chair and fly right out through your window.
It's quite possible it may do that.
we'll keep one hand on it so that it doesn't do that. But I was just going to point something out. So if you look up there in the address bar there for the URL, you'll notice that's not a publicly available website. That is an IP address locally for the actual DeepRacer. So what you're looking at here is, and correct me if I'm completely off base or saying anything wrong, but this is not the console where you sign into the AWS Amazon console. This is you connecting through your browser on your local network directly to your device, and you're interacting directly with it through this GUI.
That's absolutely correct. So basically, if this runs on your router, this is how you connect to the device. And most of the time we won't connect to the device the way that I'm doing here, which is from my computer. Most people connect via a tablet or a cell phone because you want to drive it around. So one of the things you could do is you could put it in manual mode and you get a little joystick. And this thing right here will allow you to drive the car just like a regular RC car. If you want to have some fun or, if you wanted to go chase somebody around, you could do that with this as long as you're on the network. But that's absolutely correct. This is not from the console where you train stuff. So we have two modes, autonomous mode and manual mode. And in manual mode, you're actually physically driving the car. It's not the reinforcement learning model that drives the car.
Well, I think that also answers one of the questions we had in Twitch chat about whether you can manually control one of these things. And the answer is yes. It appears as a device on your network with its own IP address. Eddie, just wanted to forward another question to you. And I think this one we're going to see throughout the rest of the demo, but here it is. How much freedom do we get for defining our own functions in the standard RL formulation? For example, can we define arbitrary policy, value, and reward functions?
Well, you can define arbitrary reward functions up on the AWS console. In fact, one of the cool things that, how we wanted to onboard people with reinforcement learning is like, the reinforcement learning, like you mentioned, I think Nick, you mentioned that it seems really scary. So what we did is, hey, let us take care of some of the reinforcement learning algorithm and let's ease you into this. And the way we're going to ease you into this is by focusing on the reward function. And so you can go on the AWS console and you can basically craft your own reward function. You can craft as many of them as you want. In terms of value functions, we currently only offered an algorithm called PPO, which stands for Proximal Policy Optimization. And we use that within an algorithm called Actor Critic. And this is all within a paradigm called the function approximation. And that's pretty much all just jargon out there. But it basically means that you don't define the value function, because the value function is in fact a neural network that you learn, which is what the actor-critic algorithm does. It basically, you're simultaneously learning a neural network for the policy and a neural network for the value function. So that was a very, very poignant question. That's a fantastic question. So you don't get to tweak the value function, but you do get to tweak the reward function all you want.
Eddie, that was a yeah. wonderful answer. And I think it sort of speaks to the depth you can take DeepRacer, right? You can use it at this very high level and get onboarded in an easy to digest manner. But if you want to really explore the underlying components of how reinforcement learning works, you know, that's possible here. And many of the folks like yourself that are probably out helping as members of the DeepRacer pick crew are the ones you can ask those questions to. So that's super awesome. I have a similar question that is equally as pointed, but much easier to answer, I think. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
All right. So you showed me that dashboard. I can hit plus and minus on speed, right?
Yep.
When am I able to take a piano pedal and use that as an IoT gas pedal for my DeepRacer device? Because that's what I'm waiting for.
Not quite yet. you're absolutely right. We actually, with the DeepRacer Evo, we increased the size of that because we found that a lot of our customers were using it, again, in the tablet or cell phone settings. So we made it bigger so it's easier for you to increase the speed. We're not quite there yet on the gas pedal.
Yeah.
I love that idea. I hope the product team's watching. They're getting a lot of good ideas here from this chat.
Yeah. How about streaming the stereo cameras to an Oculus Rift or something, and then combining that with the gas pedals and having the out-of-body experience of you driving a race car around?
The out-of-body experience of running a race car around. That's definitely a much more complex project. we're not quite there yet.
I like the even-handed handling of these crazy ideas.
Yeah, this is this is where I feel like, honestly, if I were in some of the early meetings listening to, we're gonna make a reinforcement learning powered car and build it for developers, like, that sound would probably at the time sound just as, you know, off the wall, but, you know, here we are, right? So these ideas and features come from conversations just like this, and I will bring an amazing one up from chat. Janisku, one of the returning viewers to this show, is requesting an IoT integration for the power glove. So that you can probably steer or control throttle.
Well, I would say we're always looking for new and creative ways to improve the product. So we'll definitely take those suggestions.
Diplomatically said.
That's amazing. Oh, man. awesome. So this is DeepRacer Evo. And so, you know, for folks that have worked with DeepRacer before, this in console experience, a lot of this hasn't changed, but you know, some of the new stuff, again, the toggles up for LiDAR, the ability to share both your LiDAR powered models or your traditional models without the LiDAR sensors, all still in line. So for returning folks to DeepRacer, experience looks very familiar, but now with some augmented superpowers, I guess you could say.
Yep. That's absolutely correct, and I'll log us back in here. Back up here. Hopefully I didn't forget the password. That's absolutely correct. So we've added support for these new sensors and visualizations to help you kind of see what the sensors are doing and what inputs you're actually sending to your reinforcement learning model. So it's kind of has a feel of, you're familiar with DeepRacer, you're still gonna see some of the same stuff. It's still gonna feel familiar to you, but we've added some new things to really help you get rolling with reinforcement learning.
See what you did there. Get rolling, DeepRacer. Now you're thinking with portals. We've got some more.
We've had so many puns around this product. It's kind of you kind of come to realize how many driving puns you can make in natural conversation every day. Because every time, you know, when you're talking Deep Racer, you say, well, I'm gonna drive this idea home. And it's, you know, it immediately, everybody's like, ah, you're making a pun about the Deep Racer. So it's been super cool on that front too.
Chat is going wild. I know you're probably not able to see it, so I'll just pass it along. People are waiting for the Deep Racer brains to be able to apply to a go-kart. People are wondering when there's going to be the Roomba versus Deep Racer object avoidance competition or the head-to-head comparison. this is great. I love this.
Yeah, and it's fantastic. And, you know, I would say, you know, this year we increased to 3 formats. And you know, like I said, we're constantly looking for ways to engage the community in a fun fashion. So, you know, I would just urge everybody to stay tuned and see what we can come up with here in the future.
Awesome. Yeah, so after some issues with password, you know, the hardest part about technology is still humans, as we can see. But the for next steps, the only thing we haven't shown today is quite literally hitting go on that model after it's been loaded. So you showed before loading and selecting the model. Let's say we've trained one up in the simulator. We've now loaded it onto the vehicle. Now all there is to put it down on the track and to, you know, let it go and to record the track time, right?
That's pretty much correct. I mean, we could try to. I don't know what will happen if I turn it on. I guess if everybody wants to see it, we could try it here.
we'll give it the good old college try here. We'll
give it the good old college try if I able to get the. There it is. There it is. Well, I may not have the battery charged, actually.
Oh, yeah, we're getting a vehicle battery not connected error there in the,
Yeah, so unfortunately we can't get rolling because we don't have a servo battery, to get this to go. But you're absolutely correct. All we would have to do is, hit the go switch and that would be it. And the car would just take off, so to speak.
All right.
And then, there's actually one more step. So one thing about this is that we're training, and one thing about reinforcement learning and where it is today, just as a science, is that we're training for a track. So if we just hit go, it may avoid the chair and fall down, but it hasn't really been trained on this environment, which is my living room. So it's not gonna know what to do. So if we just hit go right now, it's just gonna take a bunch of random actions. So we actually need to lay down a track so that it can pick up on the visual cues that it learned while training, and then it would actually follow the path on that track. And there's some great instructions, and I hope some folks can put it down in the chat and links to how to build your own tracks and how you can do that so you can actually have the device, you can actually see that behavior transfer from the virtual environment down to the real environment.
Wonderful. Yeah, we're going to make sure to get all those resources in chat, but I guess in recap here, you know, all of the resources for folks who are excited by this and want to get started, we have the launch blog post for Deep Racer Evo to sort of walk users through what it looks like to get started with these new data inputs or, you know, the new sensors for LiDAR and depth perception. There is the, you know, you will go into your AWS console, you can start training your own model in the simulator there. Out of curiosity, I'm actually not familiar. Is there a free tier for Deep Racer at all?
I believe there is a free tier for Deep Racer.
Okay.
Let's double check that on the chat. But I believe we do have a free tier.
Yeah. So, okay, awesome. Because where that leads us is that, you know, even short of buying any of your own hardware, if you sign up for AWS, you go into the console with whatever the free tier for train. I'd imagine it's some amount of hours for training in the simulator. You can go through the Hello World tutorial for training your first Deep Racer model, and actually, I'm pretty sure you can follow along sort of that like eagle eye view or that like POV view of your car going around the track in the simulator. So for the, you know, lump sum of $3.99, you can get your hands wet with some of this. Exciting reinforcement learning simulation.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, we have sort of an initial, if you're just new to the AWS console, we have sort of an initial primer that walks you through the steps and some of the concepts of reinforcement learning. And then once you go through that, you're pretty much ready to go and ready to train your model. So, you know, it's the fastest way to train a reinforcement learning model on the AWS DeepRacer is.
That's awesome. Thank you so much, Eddie. I couldn't think of a better guest to take us through all of the new features that we're launching with this.
Well, thank you guys. This has been awesome.
Yeah. So again, Eddie Kaleha from the senior software engineer over on Amazon AI has been with the team back since the inception of DeepRacer and is here today. Told us a lot about Evo. Showed us it in the console. Gave us the walk around. Eddie, one stop shop for everything DeepRacer. I can't thank you enough.
Well, thank you guys. This has been awesome, and thanks everybody for listening to me here for the last. A little bit.
Awesome. Well, I know chat very much enjoyed it. They really enjoyed getting to see us go hands-on with it. But the show must go on here at AWS What's Next. We are on wrapping up our second session here, but we do have a new format for our third session. Quite familiar, but with some different faces. You're probably used to Rob and I leading each session, but we've got something a little bit different here lined up for the third one. We are going to be going hands-on with AWS Copilot, and when we were thinking about people that would be the most effective hosts for this, we had to look no further than our own developer advocate team that lives on the containers team with Nathan Peck. Nathan will join in just a moment after we come back from our commercial break, but you know, we saw his name at the top of the blog post for announcing AWS Copilot, and I figured inviting him out would probably be the most effective way to tell the story of AWS Copilot for developers that are used to using ECS and containers. Gene is teasing me in chat for my hair. I know, I live across the street from a hair salon and it is still closed here in New York. But something that is not closed is Twitch. I know that was a terrible transition and segue, but to bring it all together with AWS Copilot, Nathan will be introducing himself and our esteemed guest to talk a little bit about Copilot right after the break. So stick around. We'll be back with session 3 of the day. Thanks, folks. Be right back.